Okay. So just in but right before we dive in, I do want to share that you are welcome to ask questions throughout the presentation. If you have a question, you can put it in the chat or you can wait till the end for a Q&A. I can see the chat as I'm presenting, so I can filter the questions as they come in. The questions will just come to me as a host of the webinar. So you can just message, send a chat through me, or we will have time for Q&A at the end. I will stop the recording for the Q&A at the end. That way, if you'd like to remain anonymous, asking a question, we won't have any of that stuff on the recording that will go on the YouTube page. So please, if you have questions, please put them in the chat or wait till the end, and we'll make sure to get to those. So again, for those of you who just logged on, my name is Mallory Henry. I am a Senior Coordinator of Student Assistance Programming for Caron Treatment Centers. I've been with Caron about 11 years. I've been in the behavioral health field for about 15 years, and I am the sibling of a person in long-term recovery. So that is kind of what brings us today to this passion of mine, really, which is how can parents and caregivers support other children in the home when there was a child struggling with substance use. So we'll kind of go through a couple different things in terms of impact today, but I like to just start briefly by discussing addiction as a family disease. I know a lot of you on here have probably heard that, but I like to kind of dive in a little bit about what that means. We'll discuss ways that substance use disorder affects siblings and other children in the home. And I'm talking about substance use disorder here, but it doesn't have to be substance use disorder. It could be a mental health diagnosis. It could be co-occurring mental health and substance use. It could be a developmental disability of a sibling. A lot of the things I'm sharing are coming from siblings that do have substance use disorder in the home. However, anything that's going to pull attention from one child or another to a specific child in the home, can bring out similar reactions as well. And then I will give you real tangible things that you can do to support the remaining members of the family through this process as well. I like to give really tangible things instead of just kind of giving you, what consequences it's causing without giving you, okay, so what can we do about it? So let's start with what addiction and substance use disorder is. You will hear me go between addiction, substance use disorder. I prefer the term substance use disorder. I challenge people to use substance use disorder because that is the diagnosable condition. I think there's less stigma associated with substance use disorder than the word addiction. I think people, sometimes have a visual in their head when we say the word addiction. However, I am also coming from a family where substance use disorder, it impacts a lot of my family. So I hear the words addiction, addict, because that is self-determined language for a lot of people in my family. So I challenge myself with this language shift, but you'll hear me go back and forth a little bit. So addiction is defined through the National Institute on Drug Abuse, or NIDA, as a chronic relapsing brain disease that is characterized by compulsive drug seeking and use despite harmful consequences. And it's considered a brain disease because drugs literally change the way the brain functions. It changes its structure, it changes the way it works, and it can be long lasting and lead to many harmful, often self-destructive behaviors. And my assumption is many of you are on this webinar because you know that, right? This is not news to you that substance use disorder can significantly alter how a person's brain functions. So that definition of addiction and substance use disorder paired with the definition of family is what we're really going to focus on today. And I like this definition of family because I think we also all come with our own bias and views of what the word family means. But this definition from the Ontario Center of Excellence for Youth and Child Mental Health is that family is a circle of care and support, offering enduring commitment to care for one another related either biologically, emotionally, or legally, and takes into account those who the client identifies as significant to his or her well-being. So I like this definition because sometimes I think we think family, we think in the home, blood related, but sometimes, right, family can be a larger piece. So I grew up in a family where I always say my family was a very open system, meaning I had a lot of aunts and uncles that I did not realize were not actually related to me until I was like in my 20s. So I'd be like Aunt Susie, Aunt Maggie, and I didn't realize till I was much older that they weren't actually siblings of either of my parents. They were just very close friends of my parent. And that's kind of my definition of family, is a larger unit. I also have friends whose definition of family is blood related, who's in my home. So what I always say is, yes, addiction is a family disease, but family can be very broad, right? It doesn't necessarily just impact who's blood related to that person specifically. Oftentimes it impacts anyone that loves that person or cares about that person who's struggling. So in terms of addiction or substance use disorder as a family disease, we look at the individual as really understanding them in the broader system of family. So when we look at family systems theory, prior to coming to Caron and working in our education alliance, I did in-home family-based therapy, which is a family systems approach to therapy, which means we look at the individual patient, but in the context of the family system. So the dynamics of each person in the family we look at kind of shapes that person, right? So it's a theory of human behavior that defines it as a complex system in which one member's, you know, behaviors interconnect with everyone else's in the family, right? And we look at it as a whole, which means that any change to an individual in the family is likely to influence the entire family system. And I think when we look at this, you know, for you, you guys might be saying, yeah, absolutely, right? You know, I know that this is impacting one person, but it's impacting everyone else in so many different ways. And that to me is what makes sense, right? That this, you know, we kind of look at family as a gear system, right? We have this one gear turning, but that gear helps turn so many other gears. And that's kind of what I look at if substance use disorder in the family, right? That one gear is turning, but the way that it's turning, or if it stops turning, it's going to dictate how everyone else in that family reacts, right? For better or for worse. Because we're all interconnected within our behavior. So what does a family look like that's dealing with addiction? From the outside, it could be anyone, right? A full range of socioeconomic status, any race, any religion, any cultural background. It could be a very close family to a seemingly disconnected family. It could be an intact family, divorced family, separated family, adopted family, never married family. What we know is that substance use disorder does not discriminate, right? It does not discriminate based on any of these things. But what we do know is that on the inside, most of the time it looks pretty similar, that it's chaotic, it's unpredictable. We don't know what to expect. There can often be this family rule of don't talk about it, don't trust, don't feel, right? I can tell you that I'll kind of weave my own personal story throughout this, but as in my family, we always were, you know, told to like bury our head in the sand. If you've heard that definition, right? Of like, if we don't say it out loud, if we don't tell anyone that these people are struggling with substance use, no one will know and will look like a good, perfect family. Right? If we don't tell anyone, my grandma actually has a sign by her door that she leaves to go in the garage that says, put a little lipstick on and you'll be fine. And that was always kind of that motto. If we look good from the outside, everyone thinks we're good, right? But inside it was chaotic. It was unpredictable. We didn't know what was happening. We didn't know how people were feeling. You know, there was a lot going on. And there was this kind of unspoken rule of like, don't talk about it. Cause if we talk about it, we have to acknowledge it and we have to do something with it. Okay. Sometimes children they grow up faster, right? I'll share about kind of how it impacts siblings, specifically how it impacted me. But if we have children whose parents struggle with substance use disorder, occasionally they take on a more parentified role. They might be caring for other siblings. They might be cooking dinner. As a sibling, a lot of times I took on parentified roles because my parents were tied up in helping with my brother, right? So I took on some roles of like making sure I could get to soccer practice on time, right? Because my parents were at a family session with my brother, right? Things like that. And oftentimes as family members, we engage in these exhausting efforts to rescue the person. Right? We want to save them. We want to fix it. And as a family, right? That's what we're told to do. We're told to bind together, fix it, help each other, right? Never give up on each other. That's the definition of family for a lot of us. That's the definition of a parent, right? Is to help, to fix, to make people feel better. And oftentimes we leave ourselves over here so that we can become what we think that person needs in order to save them, to fix them, to make them better. And obviously those things have consequences. And those reactions can look really different, right? So we have confronting, right? So, you know, I can think of scenarios when my brother was in active addiction where I would confront him. Are you using? Are you high right now? Right? Tell me. Very confrontational, very aggressive. Investigating, going through phones, going through cars, putting, you know, a tracker app on their car of where are you going? Where are you? You know, thinking that that's going to help us fix it. Avoiding, right? Again, I said a lot of people in my family, the sense was if we just don't talk about it, if we just don't acknowledge it, it'll just go away. We'll just avoid it. We just won't invite them to, you know, the family function. We just won't tell them it's happening. And then maybe it'll be okay. Controlling. If I pay your car insurance, you need to stay sober, right? Oftentimes we try to set boundaries, but really they're not boundaries. They're trying to control the other person. If I can just make them do this, it will stop, right? I remember at a time again in my brother's active addiction, I had a dog and he loved my dog. And I remember saying, if you just get clean, I will give you my dog. That really didn't make any sense, right? But I was so desperate in that moment to fix it that I would have done anything, right? Because I wanted to control that situation. I felt so out of control. Worrying excessively. My brother's been sober 7 years on Saturday. And I don't know if the worry ever truly fully goes away. I think I've had calls from my mom before, or she'll call me and say, your brother didn't pick up the phone. I don't know what to do. Well, he's probably at work. You know, he might be doing this. But that immediate sensation comes back of something must be wrong because he's not picking up the phone, right? My brother's been clean 7 years. He hasn't given us a reason to think that anything is concerning, but that worry doesn't necessarily go away. And then caretaking, right? If I suffer their consequences for them, if I make sure dinner's on the table every day, if I buy them the food that they really like, if I pay their car insurance, if I get them to the doctor, if I physically drive them, I'm thinking of my parents, if I physically drive them to the 12-step meeting and walk them in, right? That will alleviate this. It will fix this, right? All of these reactions are completely normal, right? It doesn't seem normal, right? But when our family member is sick, it is a completely normal reaction to do any of these things, right? That is what family does. So I want to alleviate some of that because a lot of this is normal, but a lot, we know some better ways, right? And addiction, as I like this, again, you've seen this, probably heard it, but one person may use the substance, but everyone in the family suffers. And all that suffering can look very different from each person, right? All of us interpret this completely different just based on our, you know, how we, our relationship with that person, what that looks like, what time period, what's going on. So as we kind of dive into this, I know many of you might be parents, right? Who have children where one of them is struggling. And I do like to put a disclaimer on this that I'm speaking from personal experience. However, I in no way want there to be blame, guilt, or shame. This disease already brings on these things on its own all the time, right? The shame that comes with this disease, the guilt, the blame, right? So I'm sharing things, but I want to alleviate some of that for you because as a parent, and now being a parent myself, I fully understand that you will do anything to save your child, right? You are, it's life or death situation, and you're doing everything you can to save your child. And with that should not come blame, shame, or guilt, because all of us would react the same way. Okay? So I just like to put that little disclaimer in there. So I like to start with this poem. This is a poem someone sent me a few years ago, and I immediately read it and was like, oh my gosh, I've never felt like someone knew what I was feeling as a sibling of person, someone who struggles with substance use disorder. It says, I am the other child, the okay one. I am the sober child, the one on the sidelines. I am the observer, the one watching him slowly killing our parents. I'm the angry one, the one who's pissed because he's destroying our family. I'm the sad one, the one losing her first best friend. I am the reassuring one, the one holding her mama as she cries. I am the torn one, the broken one, just trying to hold everyone together. I am the confused one, the one who wonders how we became so unimportant and invisible. I am the other child. I am the okay one. So that's an anonymous author, but it was the first time, you know, I had, you know, worked in this field, even, you know, working in recovery, working in prevention. And I saw this poem and I was like, oh, other people have felt this way. I didn't realize that. I thought it was just me. I had never seen it in black and white words, right? I'd never been able to put in words how I felt. And when I started working with families and with siblings, I realized many other siblings felt the same way, right? They just weren't sure how to word it, with especially without putting any guilt or shame or blame on their parents, who were just doing the best that they could with a really dire situation. So I want to kind of talk about some of the things within that poem, because there is a lot of impact on siblings that a lot of times we don't really acknowledge. And some of that impact is because our family is beyond bandwidth. Everyone is just trying to stay afloat, right? The bandwidth has been expired. We are going to exhausting lengths. We are exhausted. We are tired. And we are beyond bandwidth as a family. And what that can mean for other children in the home, when a lot of time and devotion and focus is put on one child, is that the other children might have unmet developmental needs. They might have impaired attachments with their sibling or with their parents. They might feel underappreciated, overlooked. You saw in the poem, it said, how did I become so invisible, so unimportant? Emotionally spent, but not themselves in crisis. Divided allegiance and guilt. Do I tell my parents that I know my brother's using again? Or is my allegiance to my brother? Right? Because it's always been us against my parents. It becomes this, who do I side with? Who do I talk to? We can have parentified kids that we talked about, taking on a more parental role because devotion and time is spent other places. Lack of attention to that other sibling. And family resources and energy are being overspent. So we'll look at some of these a little bit more specifically. But I think a lot of times seeing these, we don't realize as much that some of these things are how the other children might be feeling. So let's look at financial impact. The identified patient, so the person struggling with substance use disorder, could steal from family and friends. My brother stole from me, you know, to buy drugs. In complete transparency, I remember, you know, I would call my mom and say, is my brother coming to Christmas? And if she said yes, I would lock my purse in the car. Right? I would not bring my purse in my grandparents' house because I did not trust my brother to not steal my things because he had done that many times in the past. Right? My brother's treatment, medical care, medication was very expensive to my family. From my own personal perspective, my parents, I was in college when my brother was probably most in his active addiction. And because of paying for treatment for my brother, they were unable to pay for college for me. And when I had gone to college, it was the expectation that they would help support me going to college financially. I'm still in debt from my undergrad because I did not go into college assuming that I would be paying for it all. And it was necessary for me to take out loans in the middle of my freshman year of college because my parents had to use the money that was devoted for me to go to college to send my brother to treatment. So that financial impact has been impacting me for almost 20 years, even though my brother's been sober for a good chunk of my adult life. Attorney fees, court fees, legal fees, right? That is money that's being spent on one child, which means that the finances can't necessarily give the other children what they would potentially have without those parents having that, right? Like when my parents and I sat down and said, I'm going to go to college, this is what this is going to look like. We had conversations about finances, right? And that completely changed because my parents' finances changed because of needing to spend so much money on my brother. There was court fees, there was attorney fees, and there was treatment that was very expensive to get Tim to a place that he can be sober today. My brother stole my car at one point. And my parents ended up saying, you know what? He needs it. He needs to get around. You're in college. You don't need a car. But that cost me money. And I, again, one of the things I come from this lens of now as a parent is, again, my parents were doing what they felt they needed to do. And honestly, what they did need to do to keep my sibling alive, right? So I don't hold a lot of resentment towards any of that because now looking back on it, I can say they really were doing everything they can. And I appreciate that because I still have a brother, right? Supporting the patient and or patient's children. Many of you might be raising grandchildren. Which also means that, you know, those grandchildren might get more of, you know, parents' attention than other grandchildren because they're in the home or they need more because their parents are sick and struggling. But there's a financial impact to that. And opportunities for siblings might be reduced because of financial impact, right? So I talked about college, but vacations, you know, if there was a family vacation and we stopped going on family vacations, hobbies, interests, right? Hey, you might not be able to do this because we don't have the money right now because we need to pay for treatment. We have court fees. You know, we have all these co-pays for doctors. Life in general might have less opportunities for the other children because of the devotion and finances spent on that individual child that's sick. So as I go through this, what I did was I polled a lot of siblings. I had about 30 siblings who answered some questions for me about how their siblings' use affected them. And I want to share these with you because I can share my perspective, but I like to share other perspectives as well that kind of reinforce some of these ways that siblings are impacted. So this person says, I never conveyed my internal struggles with losing the emotional connection with my sibling and the pain it caused me when I couldn't trust my own sibling. For example, the fear of him selling my belongings for money for drugs. I looked at him as a threat for a while, in a way that when I had to hide or lock away my personal belongings when I was around him. There was a lot of lying, stealing, manipulation. His addiction cost us our family ties for many years, money, hardship. This was a sibling who's saying, I personally have spent thousands digging him out of debt and trying to help him as a sibling. Okay. So that sibling taking on ownership of that debt. You know, my parents were at, and this sibling had said, my parents were at max capacity, but my brother needed treatment. So I took out a loan to help support that person to go to treatment, right? So that sibling took on a parentified role, but also put herself in debt to save her brother. So let's talk a little bit about physical impact, because sometimes this is the one we don't talk a lot about, the actual physical impact to siblings. So we could see medical conditions exacerbated by stress, headaches, migraines, psychosomatic concerns. I can tell you that when I was in college and my brother was in his active addiction, I ended up in the ER for optical migraines, which threw a lot of family treatment and recovery in my own, you know, therapy process and treatment and recovery, learned that most of that came from anxiety, right? Many of my migraines were triggered by anxiety because I was constantly worried that my brother was dead, right? I was constantly waiting for that phone call from my parent. Every time my phone rang, you know, I was worried my parents were going to tell me something happened to my brother. So my own anxiety was triggering physical implications, exhaustion, not sleeping, you know, wondering again, you know, if the phone rang in the middle of the night, I was picking it up. I was looking at who it was because I didn't know what was going to be on the other end of that phone. So it was constant, you know, exhaustion, violence and threats. You know, I think one of the things that sometimes shocks us with substance use disorder is the change kind of in that values and morals of that person. because they're just, their brain's not functioning. But my brother is a wonderful, kind person. But when he was in his active addiction, could be very physical, very aggressive. I watched him be in physical fights with friends, with family members, because, you know, he was, again, not himself. But there was violence that I was witnessing as a sibling in my home, which is not something I had ever done before. Routine medical care could be overlooked, right? If my parents are so invested in this sibling, they might forget that I have a physical I need to get for my soccer team, or, you know, routine medical care, because they're hyper-focused on a patient, you know? So I did ask siblings, how has your sibling's substance use physically affected your life? And you're going to see a lot of very similar answers here. Stress, chaos, crazy moments and scenarios that I was drug into, talking to someone under the influence at a young age, being exposed to some explicit, slightly traumatizing things at a young age. This sibling was much younger than their sibling who was struggling with substance use. So talked a lot about how she felt like she saw things that she shouldn't have been seeing at a young age because her sibling was using substances. And we know that stress is bad for the body, right? And that's one of the hardest things about this. As you know, parents, or as someone in general who loves someone with substance use, the impact of the stress on your own physical health can be really challenging, right? And sometimes we don't look at it like that. We'll be like, gosh, I have a lot of headaches. Gosh, I can't sleep really well. And sometimes we can't put that together. That's because of everything that's going on, right? And those, again, are normal reactions, right? Our body going into fight or flight, or having anxiety, or increased stress is a normal reaction to a scary situation, right? We want our body to react that way. That's what keeps us alive as humans. So we always say that's really what our body does. So if we're in a forest and there's a bear, right, our pupils are going to dilate, our heart's going to race, our palms are going to sweat, because we evolutionary need to decide if we're going to fight that bear or run from that bear, right? And that's really great if there's a bear, right? But what if that bear is my brother, right? And it's constant unpredictability in my home, right? There's constant stress, there's constant anxiety. That fight or flight can be really health damaging to us as well, physically and emotionally, right? There's anxiety, there's worry, there's fear. You know, I, again, constantly was worried about, was my brother alive? Is he okay? Is he using? Did he relapse? Is he sober? What's he doing? Who's he with? Right? Constantly worrying. And also being on the other end of my parents' worry, right? So every time we would talk on the phone, right, I would get from my parents, oh, I don't know where your brother is, or he was sleeping on a park bench last night, or I'm so worried he got arrested. You know, I was owning a lot of their feelings as well in that sense. Guilt from setting limits or cutting off the relationship. So I can tell you that I am very grateful to have a brother that is in recovery, but my husband is also the sibling of a person who struggles with substance use disorder, who has had a brother in active addiction for most of his adult life, continues to be in active addiction. And we have had to set a lot of boundaries with him in our lives. And that brings on a lot of guilt. There was a time where, you know, when we were getting married, we had to sit down and discuss whether or not he was going to be invited to our wedding. That was not something my husband ever thought would be a conversation, right? His brother was one of his best friends growing up. So there's a lot of guilt around, how do I set a limit around my own mental health can take, around, you know, what's happening with my sibling. You know, there's a lot of guilt about that. Emotional numbing, you know, if your house is constantly chaos or unpredictable, oftentimes our brain looks for ways to numb that. So that could mean substance use of our own, right? That could mean emotionally numbing in a different way. It could mean our own mental health concerns. Putting our own needs last, right? One of the things I love about the poem is that it says that I am the okay one. And oftentimes I remember having conversations with my parents as we worked through a lot of our family recovery, as I call it, of I felt like I had to be okay. because you already had one child that was sick. I couldn't do that to you too. I couldn't be another sick child. I couldn't be another child making a bad choice. I felt like I had to be perfect. And working with a lot of siblings, that is very, very common. Many siblings feel they need to be perfect. They need to be this golden child, right? Because they can't put their parents through that. And in turn, getting less attention. I remember saying to my parents, I do everything right. I get straight A's. I played soccer. I went to college. I got a scholarship. I did all these things I was supposed to do. And no one paid attention to it because everyone was so busy worrying about my brother, right? And so I kind of took on that perfectionist mindset of like, oh my gosh, in order to get attention, I'm going to need to be even more perfect, right? I'm going to need to be this perfect person who never makes mistakes because I can't be another person who's not great for my parents. And we see trauma-like symptoms, hyperarousal, hypervigilance, right? What's going on? What's happening? Constant feeling like you need to be this strong person because you have to take on the roles of the family. Right? I'm not saying every sibling feels like this. I can only speak to this, what siblings have shared with me and how I felt. There's a lot of common themes when I work with siblings. And one of them is I need to be this perfect child. I need to take on everything in the family so that I can fix it. Right. And that reminded me specifically of this video that I want to show after I show some of these quotes, because we often as siblings are feel like we need to put our needs last, that we can't be a focus. I have to be a caretaker. I worry every day. I'm just trying to keep everyone around me happy. Not getting my needs met caused my own mental illness. I work with a lot of siblings who will say that the addiction of someone in my family brought on my own anxiety, my own depression, my own mental health diagnosis. And so this is not uncommon. And I put all these quotes in here to show you that this is not just one person saying this. This is many people saying this. And again, these are common reactions. It doesn't mean they're bad. There are ways to help siblings through this that we'll talk about. This person says, I felt alone a lot. I felt ignored a lot. I felt like I had to be quiet and perfect and funny and strong and positive to make up for everything else that was going on. I couldn't need anything because she was occupying all of their time and energy. Right? So this, again, this needing to be strong. And this brings me to this. So I don't know if any of you have seen the movie Encanto. I have young children, so I've seen it probably more than I probably should. I could probably recite it at this point. But when I was watching this movie, when it came out, I was in the movie theater with my kids and this song came on. And the song's called Surface Pressure. And it's about a sibling who feels the need to be very strong. And I remember listening to the song and I was like, this is a great song. And then about halfway through the song, I was like, this song is about me. This song is my life. This is exactly how I feel. And it circulated the internet for a while and it got brought back to me several times because a lot of my friends know what I do for a living. And quite a few of them shared stories that they saw on the internet of siblings who had substance use disorder in the home or had mental health or developmental disability of another sibling who really resonated with the lyrics of this song. So it's about 3 minutes. It's just the lyrics, but I want you to read them because I think this does a really great job of making it tangible of what a sibling might feel.
I'm the strong one. I'm not nervous. I'm as tough as the crust of the earth is. I move mountains, I move churches, and I glow cause I know what my worth is. I don't ask how hard the work is. Got a rough, indestructible surface. Diamonds and platinum, I find them, I flatten them. I take what I'm handed, I break what's demanded. But under the surface, I feel berserk as a tightrope walker in a three-ring circus. Under the surface, was Hercules ever like, yo, I don't wanna fight Cerberus? Under the surface, I'm pretty sure I'm worthless if I can be of service. A flaw or crack, the straw in the stack. Drip, that'll never stop. Whoa. Pressure that'll dip, dip, dip.
I love that song when you listen to the lyrics, because I do think a lot of siblings can relate to it. I have a close friend whose brother is diagnosed with autism, and her and I talk a lot about what that was like for me growing up with a brother who has substance use disorder and what it was like for her growing up with a brother who had a developmental disability. And we felt very similar. And she was actually the first person that called me when she saw that movie and said, "Oh my gosh, did that song immediately make you cry?" And I was like, yes, 100%, because I was the sister who felt like I had to burden. Give it to me. I'll take it. I'll be strong, because I felt like I had to be strong for everyone around me. So I feel like that song does a really great job of kind of putting into words and putting into music sometimes what we feel like as a sibling who feels like we need to be the strong one, and kind of says, okay, so what do we do with this? Because on the surface, I look really strong. I look like I can handle it. But underneath, I'm really struggling. That movie actually goes on to say that if we talk about what's going on, if we share what's happening and how we feel, at the end of the day, we feel better. And I really love that message, because I do think when we talk about family recovery, I completely agree with that. Me sharing my story, sharing how I felt, has allowed a lot of recovery in my life and my family's as well. Let's talk a little bit about invisible impacts, things that come up when I talk to siblings that don't really fit in the category of emotional, physical, or financial. A change in the sibling relationship. Siblings, sometimes we're really good friends with our siblings, sometimes we're not. There's no right or wrong to what that looks like, but that relationship is going to change, right? It's going to look potentially different. I know for me, there was a lot of resentment that had to be worked through in order to have a relationship with my brother. Who to have allegiance to? Again, do I side with my parents? Do I side with my brother, right? There are times my brother was sober 5 years initially and relapsed. I knew my brother had relapsed. I worked in this field. I could see every single sign. I knew my brother was struggling. And I really struggled with, do I go to my parents, because they did not think my brother had relapsed? Or do I go to my brother and say, hey, do you need help? Can I help you? I did go to my parents at one point, and they were like, nope, he's fine. Why do you have to throw your brother under the bus? He's doing fine. And my brother had relapsed, and he really did need help. But that was a hard part of a relationship with my family, of me knowing something and not sure who to go to with it, can sometimes be really impactful. It can strain the parent-child relationship. I really struggled with my parents' reaction to my brother's use. You know, as a sibling, I was like, just put boundaries up, just kick him out. Why are you keep giving him money? Right now, again, growing up and having my own children, I understand why my parents were doing that, because I would want to make my kids healthy and better, no matter what that took. But at the time I was very upset with my parents and very mad at them. And it strained our relationship for a long time. It just didn't look the way I wanted it to. There was a lot of guilt and shame of my own. A lot of my friends knew my brother. You know, we had neighborhood friends, and there was a lot of shame and guilt that came with that as well. You know, downplaying their own successes, again, saying, you know, I know you need to focus on this, so I'm just not even going to tell you, you know, what's going on in my life. You know, now having substance use disorder in the family impacts me, as a sibling long after, because I have my own children, right? And I know that my children genetically have substance use disorder on both sides. So that is going to impact how I parent. It's going to impact my own children's future, my risk of substance use disorder, as well. And it's going to impact my relationships. I can tell you that from a personal standpoint, when my brother was in his active addiction, I was in a really unhealthy romantic relationship, because I had built a lot of walls up. I didn't trust a lot of people. You know, I was pushing people away because I didn't trust people, because I didn't know what that looked like at the time. I hadn't seen, you know, a healthy family system. I wasn't sure what that was supposed to look like because I hadn't seen it. Because my family was very chaotic internally. It looked great from the outside, right? Oftentimes when, you know, we started being honest about my brother's substance use, the number one thing was, gosh, we never knew, right? Your family looks so fine, right? And that was the MO, right? We wanted it to look fine, because we didn't want anyone to know. But I always say that because it doesn't discriminate. It could look like any family. So here's some quotes from siblings. I miss my sister and our friendships we once shared. I had a baby back in September, and it hurts me that she will never know my sister before addiction made her so sick. She also has her own daughter, and it's really hard for me to comprehend how she doesn't have a relationship with her daughter like I have with mine. It hurts to watch my niece grow up and wonder where her mom is every night, right? So that sibling's talking about what that looks like as being an aunt and how that role of an aunt has been significantly impacted. It's affected my schooling, my mental health, my friendships, my relationships. Our relationship is very transactional. I hear this a lot from siblings. Over 10 years of frequent relapses, once I had children of my own, I felt the need to protect them from the drama and my own memories with my kids, to be focused around them and not, you know, my brother's state. My brother and I went from being extremely close to barely speaking due to his alcohol use in his 20s. Our relationship is better now, but is definitely the thing we can't talk about. His choice, not mine. I don't feel like I can really count on him for anything. And part of me is always waiting for the phone call he has taken his drinking too far. Okay. So again, there's kind of that invisible load that these siblings are carrying, that I will say a lot of parents don't realize. Because they're carrying so much of their own. This sister I spoke to, her sister had passed away from an overdose. She said, my sister died in 2017, but when she's passed, I hadn't spoken to her in years. I thought about her constantly, and I felt like I was a bad person for not having a relationship with her. But after she's died, I spent a lot of time beating myself up over it. And my dad reminded me that what we did, all we tried with her relationship, but she pushed us away because she was ashamed. She had been my best friend when I was younger. And as her addiction got worse, she turned on me. It was some of the most painful times I can remember. And I could never really feel connected with her too much after a few rounds of getting clean. It caused a lot of tension over the years. And this sibling, when I talked to her, she had done a lot of her own work in therapy because she felt very, very guilty for her sibling's death. She felt like if she would not have cut her out, she felt that if she would have done more, if she would have done this, it would have saved her. And she is also someone who was, when I was talking to her, was like, I'm so glad this is being brought up because I never felt like I could be honest about how I felt, as a sibling. So I know some of that is really hard to hear. So I want to really talk about, so what can we do here? There are real tangible things that we can do as family members who love someone, with a substance use disorder, but also love our other children, right? So what can we do? One of the things I asked for people to tell me was when your sibling was, or if your sibling received any sort of treatment, were you offered support for yourself as a sibling? Right? And you can see here that 70%, now this is a small, again, we only had 30 people, but I see this fairly commonly. 70% said, no one ever offered me support. Right. And I can tell you that was my perspective. I remember talking to my parents and saying, you know, you go to meetings with my brother, you go to family sessions, you go to education, you get invited to all these things. He was in and out of treatment several times. I was never invited to any of it, not explicitly. I don't think anyone ever said like, they can't come. But it wasn't, hey, it was always parents, parents, parents. And I always felt like I was not invited to those things, or I wasn't given a place at that table. And oftentimes siblings really feel that way. You know, it'll say parents and caregivers. And I don't think anyone's being discriminatory in like a parent support group. However, you know, what about siblings, families? And again, I think one of the next slides I want to show you is I also surveyed people who were under the age of 18. And at this one, most of the kids said yes, they did receive. So 60% of people over 18 said no, around 60% of people under 18 said I did. What this shows me is we're doing such a better job supporting the whole family, not just the person struggling, not just the parents, but everyone who's impacted. And so this makes me feel so much better that we are doing so much more to say, we know this is affecting you. Here's how we can help. And you are not alone. So what can we encourage? What can you encourage your child or other children to do? The number one thing I always say is you can tell them that their feelings are valid. Okay? They are allowed to be frustrated, angry, upset, anxious, stressed. And oftentimes what we do as parents, right, is we want to say, oh, don't feel that way. Feel better, right? We want to fix it, right? We want to fix those uncomfortable feelings for them because we don't want our kids to be uncomfortable. So we might say like, oh no, you know, you're not upset. You can do this instead. Instead of saying, you're right. You have every right to be angry at your brother. That's an extremely valid feeling for what's going on in our family right now. And that can be hard to say because with that feels like it comes some sort of admission. But what I say to all of you as well, that no matter what you're feeling, the feeling is valid. There's no such thing as a bad feeling. Some are more comfortable than others, but all of our feelings are valid. They're there for a reason, right? We feel them for a reason. So validate whatever it is that they're feeling. Allow them to set boundaries around their own relationship with their sibling. And you might not like them, and that's okay. But their boundaries are their boundaries. Your boundaries are your boundaries, right? So I can give you an example of my husband. His mom has since passed, but when his mom was still alive, his mom obviously tried to save her son who was in active addiction in any way she could. And that brought on a lot of resentment from my husband. And eventually his boundary with his mom was, hey, when we're together, I would like to not talk about my brother. I would like it to be about us and our relationship and your grandkids, and not about that. And that was a boundary he asked for her to respect, and she did. Okay? And it made him feel validated in his feelings. I'm sure that was incredibly challenging for his mom. Right? His mom wanted her sons to be friends and get along and see each other, but she was able to respect that boundary, which allowed my brother to feel seen, or allowed my husband to feel seen and heard. Okay. So allowing them to set their own boundaries, providing them with opportunities for their own self-care. Okay. Can we ensure that they get to do the things that they enjoy? Allowing space for them to communicate how they're feeling when they are ready, right? A lot of times there's this, how are you feeling? Tell me how you're feeling. Let me fix it. Let me do this. Instead of just saying, I'm here when you're ready to have a conversation about this. Okay? When you're ready to talk about it, I will allow, you know, I will respect your feelings, however you're feeling, and I will just listen. And this is something that took a long time in part of our, I would say, our family recovery. One of the things I know about my mom is a fixer. So if I call my mom and I say, I'm having a rough time with, you know, my dog, you know, being outside, she's going to be like, well, have you tried this? Have you tried this? What about this? What about this? And I love my mom for that. But there are some times I don't want her to fix things. I just want her to listen, right? So one of the biggest changes in my mom and my relationship was I call her now and I'll say, I want solutions, or I'll say, I just want you to listen, right? And my mom will respect whatever I ask of her, right? Because there are sometimes I call my mom and I really do want her help and I want her solutions and I want her to give me examples. There are sometimes I just want to vent. A lot of times I know the solution, it just really stinks and I don't want to do it, right? But, you know, I want her to say and just respond with, yeah, that's really hard. So I'll say to her, I just want you to validate my feelings. I don't want you to fix it, and respecting that. And that's a conversation we've had, you know, this is what I need from you and I need you to respect what I need from you. So allowing space for that. So one of the questions is, how do we validate feelings? How do I allow space to not fix? Right? So some really tangible things. You listen, right? A lot of times that we say we listen to respond instead of listening to hear, right? So sometimes I have to check myself with even my own kids because I listen to respond, right? If they're telling me like, oh, so-and-so ran away from me at recess, I want to be like, did you talk to the teacher? Did you do this? Like all these things, instead of just saying, you know, what do you think happened there? How were you feeling when that happened to you? Right? Or that must have made you really sad when that happened. That's a different response than saying, you know, oh, you should go tell the teacher if that child's, you know, being mean to you. Repeating their feelings. So, you know, and this sometimes sounds crazy, right? If my son is slamming the door because he's super mad at me, my response might be, you seem really angry right now at me. Okay. Which sounds crazy when you're slamming the door, because, you know, I was brought up in a family, you slam the door. I remember my parents being like, I'm going to take that door off the hinges, right? Instead of validating the feeling I had, because if you don't validate the feeling, a lot of times we think it's not okay to feel that way, right? So if we're constantly told you shouldn't be mad. That's not good. Mad is bad, right? We grow up thinking we can't be upset. We can't be angry. And that's not feasible. There are times in life you're going to be angry. It's what we do with that feeling that's either appropriate or inappropriate. So we validate, and what that looks like can be repeating the feeling, right? So if I said to my mom, hey, you know, I felt growing up that you didn't treat me fairly and that you gave my brother more attention, instead of her saying, no, I didn't. Remember that time I did this for you? She might say, it sounds like you feel like you were treated unfairly sometimes. That's it. Just kind of repeating back what that person's saying. And you don't need to feel like you need to agree with everything, right? You might not agree that their reaction is, you know, reciprocal. You might say like, why are you feeling so angry? Why are you so upset by this? But instead of arguing with the way they feel, just agree with it. I can see why you feel that way, right? Or I understand that you feel this way, right? It just allows the person to feel heard and not feel like whatever they're feeling isn't valid. And keep the focus on the person sharing. You know, sometimes it's easy to say, you know, if I said to my mom, hey, I feel like I was treated really unfair, her response would be, but your brother needed that, right? We needed to do this for him, right? And oftentimes I would say, I just want you to say, yes, you're right. You felt upset. You felt angry. You felt resentful, right? That's it. Just kind of that responding and keeping the focus on the person in front of you instead of bringing up why this person needed so many things. Right. And the hardest part as a parent is don't jump to fix or give advice, right? Allow them to express and then ask, right? So you can say, do you want solutions or you just want me to listen? And I'll respect whatever you tell me, right? I say that to my own kids now who are 8 and 6, because I know how much that means to me when my parents do it, right? Do you want me to give you solutions? Do you just want me to listen? You tell me and I'll do it. Because sometimes we don't want anyone to fix. We just want to feel heard. So we can ask our kids, how do you feel? How has this impacted you? A lot of siblings I talked to said, gosh, no one's ever asked me that. No one's ever asked me how this impacted me, right? So sometimes this simple question as how has this impacted you can be really powerful. Set aside one-on-one time with no distractions with that child. Hey, can we go grab a cup of coffee together? Right? Just me and you. Allow for the boundaries of their choosing. Like we said, their boundaries are their boundaries. Your boundaries are your boundaries. One of my favorite things around boundaries I heard actually was just recently that oftentimes we feel like boundaries are setting fences around other people's yards and saying, you know, you need to stay over there. But really a boundary is setting a fence around our own yard and dictating who we let come into that fence, right? So my boundary can be different than my parents, right? And we've done a lot of exercises around boundaries because I would get really frustrated that my parents' boundaries didn't look like mine. And at the end of the day, what we realized was that our value systems are slightly different and that's okay, right? And that because my value systems are different, I'm gonna have different boundaries with my brother. And there's nothing wrong with that. We can respect everyone's own boundaries around that relationship. You can provide education on substance use disorder. Right? What does that look like? Inviting them to the table, sharing webinars with them. Kids know that it's affecting them. And sometimes they don't get the same education we do as adults. Right? So what does that look like? Realizing that they're not alone. Encouraging themselves to get counseling, to have someone they can talk to themselves. And encourage support group and education. I can tell you that we, you know, through Caron, offer a lot of family support. There's a lot of other amazing agencies that offer family support. Please look at them, provide the information. One of the things I say too is, you know, you can say to your other children, here are resources. It doesn't mean you say you need to go to this, right? Hey, here's some resources I heard about. If and when you're interested or ready, these things exist. There tends to be a lot more support over the age of 18 necessarily than under. Caron does offer a children and teens program for ages 7 to 17 who are impacted by a loved one's substance use disorder, because obviously those kids need a different education set than people over the age of 18, but they're still significantly impacted. And oftentimes we get kids whose parents are using substances, but we also have a lot of siblings, you know, children who have siblings who are struggling. We provide a strategies in family recovery support group through a workshop through Caron. We actually hold that. We have one in DC on April 15th. So if you're local to that region, that's doable. I will put all that info in the chat. There's also a podcast called My Child and Addiction. I did an episode with them on siblings. They have a couple episodes on siblings. I put that link in the chat as well. It's a phenomenal resource for parents and loved ones. It's directed at parents, but I'm a sibling and have listened to it and feel like it's a phenomenal resource. Anything you can provide so that someone doesn't feel like they're the only one can be really powerful. And then the last thing I want to really touch on is that we can provide empathy for the other children, not just sympathy. And this can be a challenging concept because sympathy is a feeling of pity or sorrow. Like, gosh, I'm really sorry that happened to you. That's really awful. I'm really sorry you feel that way. Empathy is the one-on-one connection because of a deep understanding that comes from a shared emotional experience. I understand what you're feeling. So empathy fuels connection. Sympathy drives disconnection. A lot of this empathy versus sympathy comes from the work of Brené Brown. If you have not read any of her books, I highly recommend them. But she does a lot of education around shame. But with that, she does a lot of how do we reduce shame? And one of the ways to reduce shame is to one, talk about it, and two, provide empathy. Right? And those are things, real tangible things we can do. So I want to watch this video clip.
So what is empathy and why is it very different than sympathy? Empathy fuels connection. Sympathy drives disconnection. Empathy, it's very interesting. Teresa Wiseman is a nursing scholar. who studied professions, very diverse professions, where empathy is relevant, and came up with four qualities of empathy. Perspective taking, the ability to take the perspective of another person or recognize their perspective as their truth. Staying out of judgment, not easy when you enjoy it as much as most of us do. Recognizing emotion in other people and then communicating that. Empathy is feeling with people. And to me, I always think of empathy as this kind of sacred space when someone's kind of in a deep hole and they shout out from the bottom and they say, I'm stuck, it's dark, I'm overwhelmed. And then we look and we say, hey, you can climb down. I know what it's like down here, and you're not alone. Sympathy is, ooh, it's bad, uh-huh. No, you want a sandwich? Empathy is a choice, and it's a vulnerable choice, because in order to connect with you, I have to connect with something in myself that knows that feeling. Rarely, if ever, does an empathic response begin with at least. And we do it all the time. Because you know what? Someone just shared something with us that's incredibly painful, and we're trying to silver lining it. I don't think that's a verb, but I'm using it as one. We're trying to put the silver lining around it. So, I had a miscarriage. Oh, at least you know you can get pregnant. I think my marriage is falling apart. At least you have a marriage. John's getting kicked out of school. At least Sarah is an A student. But one of the things we do sometimes in the face of very difficult conversations is we try to make things better. If I share something with you that's very difficult, I'd rather you say, I don't even know what to say right now. I'm just so glad you told me. Because the truth is, rarely can a response make something better. What makes something better is connection.
So I think that video does a really great job of kind of sharing the differences there between sympathy and empathy, because it is really abstract. But I love what she ends with there, is that the response is not what's going to fix anything. We often think it is, but it's not. The connection we make with that person. And it is really uncomfortable when someone is standing in front of us being incredibly vulnerable, because we have to make a decision. Do we put our walls up, or do we be vulnerable too? And what she says is sympathy is kind of putting that wall up to say, that really stinks. Sorry you're having to go through that, right? Empathy is, gosh, I couldn't imagine what that's like. Or thank you for sharing that with me. Or hey, I've been in a similar situation before, right? So it's putting yourself in someone else's shoes, but allowing their shoes to be their own. Right? Staying out of judgment and listening. I love that she says that's hard, because it's incredibly hard, right? To stay out of judgment, recognizing an emotion that you might have felt before, right? And communicating that you can recognize that emotion. Gosh, I know what it feels like to feel lost, resentful, shame. I know what that's like, right? That provides that connection that allows for empathy, right? And again, as a parent, sometimes it's really hard to lean into empathy, because we don't want our kids to feel that way. We don't ever want them to feel uncomfortable, ever, right? That's why we want to fix. But I think what we've learned over time is that allowing them to feel uncomfortable actually removes a lot of the stigma. It actually allows us to be more vulnerable and allows us to heal as a family. Right? Substance abuse and addiction is not an isolated, minimum impact issue, but affects and attacks as many as it can. And thus collaboration amongst all the role players and stakeholders should be key to address its many concerning facets, right? I often say it's really hard for a person to recover if everyone around them is still sick, right? I truly believe that my brother, part of, not all of it, but part of his relapse 5 years in was because we never did the work as a family. We didn't. We let him do the work, right? And said, you need to fix this and everything else will come together. And it didn't. It didn't fix anything. My family was still really broken from a lot of the distrust and the resentment and the shame. And when my brother went through treatment the second time, We went to family engagement, part of Caron's treatment. We talked as a family. We got our own therapist. We had really hard, vulnerable conversations. And I truly feel that because we allowed our own selves to heal, we were able to heal as a family. And my brother was allowed to focus on his recovery. And we were allowed to focus on our own recovery. So I often will times will also say my own recovery, right? I am not in recovery from substance use, but I am a family member in recovery from the impact of substance use disorder, right? So I talk a lot about my family's recovery. Oops. And as a family, what we can do is discuss what our boundaries are going to be with each other and respect everyone's boundaries. We can try to effectively communicate. And we can get our own help, right? The way you help heal the world is to start with your own family, right? I often say, I don't think I would be in a place to do this work if I hadn't worked through what that looked like for me as a sibling, especially with my family. And just some quotes from siblings around, what do you wish your parents knew, right? I wish they had been honest with me. Right? This sibling talked about how their parents lied to them a lot and omitted a lot because they felt like they were too young to know kind of the nitty gritty details of what was going on. And she said, I know they were trying to protect me. But my other sisters were older as well. I ended up feeling isolated and that no one wanted to talk to me. Eventually they had me see a counselor and that really helped. And I wish my family had received help as a unit, not just individual therapy. Alcohol abuse affects the entire family. Just because one child doesn't abuse alcohol doesn't mean he or she is coping. Ignoring the impact is not healthy. My parents made me into this golden child, but all that did was create a conflict between me and my brother because I was in no way okay. How upset it made me that I made all the right choices and it seemed to somehow get bypassed by their negative behaviors, right? And all of these things significantly resonate with me as well. But so what I want to end with, because I know a lot of this is hard, is that recovery is possible. And not only is it possible, it's probable. You know, a lot of times when we're in it, it seems like no one recovers, right? It seems like it's so challenging, but there's a lot of people in recovery who live amazing, full, vulnerable, intimate lives, amazing lives in recovery. Roughly 2.3 Americans, more than 9% of adults live in recovery of some source. That's approximately a 75% recovery rate. That's an amazing number. Again, we don't talk about that. Our brains, we tend to do what we call social norming, which is assume that because one person is struggling, everyone struggles, right? That makes us kind of feel better when we lump it together. But for the most part, people recover, right? And that your family can heal. It is a process. Right? I can tell you, my mom and my dad and I, we've all been through lots of recovery just this past weekend. My brother's getting married. That has brought on some own of its triggering things when talking about alcohol at a wedding, right? With two people in recovery. We have continue to have really hard, vulnerable conversations as a family and communicate how we're feeling and what boundaries we feel we need to set. And that has allowed our family to heal because we see it as a process. Right? This isn't something that we can just do once and never again, right? It's something we will do forever as a family. And a lot of the siblings I talked to did provide a lot of feelings of hope, right? We have, you know, I've talked to a lot of siblings who it had tragic ends, and that's a real, you know, real possibility as well. But I also talked to a lot of siblings who have a great relationship with their sibling now, better than they ever could have imagined, right? As hard as it's been, it's ultimately made us closer. I think I'm closer to my parents because what we've gone through as a family. And I love this quote. We've had a roller coaster of a relationship, best friends, sisters, but definitely been through trials. I've protected her, enabled her, bailed her out, yelled at her, protected her again, hidden her keys, cried with her, cut her off, protected her, nearly called the police on her, but I've always loved her. And just struggled with what the right answer was, how to best help her at any given time. And now our bond is unlike any other. And even though we've been through so much, we are both better, stronger people because of the challenges we've had. And I often say that about my family. I say that about me as a person, right? I don't think I would be as good of a parent as I am if I hadn't experienced the challenges of having substance use disorder. I come at parenting from a different perspective. As well. And this is one of my favorite quotes, so I'll end with this. In Japan, broken objects are often repaired with gold. The flaw is seen as a unique piece of the object's history, which adds to its beauty. So instead of attempting to put the bowl back together and make it look like it never broke, right? Highlight that the broken pieces are what makes it so unique and so pretty. And that's one of my favorite things, actually, when I saw this quote framed, my family had walked into a family therapist office and we were in the waiting room and I saw this framed and I'll never forget the moment I read that. It gave me a lot of hope in that, you know, yes, this has been extremely challenging, but we can grow from this and we have. My brother is one of my favorite people in the world. He's a phenomenal person. He's marrying a phenomenal other person in recovery. And we have a really great, intimate, vulnerable relationship that I probably never could have envisioned at all if you would have asked me 15 years ago if that would be the case, because we've both learned and grown so much in how to share, how to be vulnerable, and how to be empathetic to each other in those situations. So I do have some resources in here. Again, I will share the PowerPoint with all of you so you have it. But I did want to put some of the resources that I pulled in here as well. And my email is on here. I have been communicating with you. So if you've received my emails from the Zoom, you have it. I will also send you another email with a link to the recording. But I consider myself a resource for you guys. So if anything I said, anything I could help with, please don't hesitate to reach out to me. I am happy to support you in any way I can, or connect you with support groups, with resources, with research, anything like that. So please don't ever hesitate to ask. So I'm going to stop the recording.